Welcome to Desi Plaza TV. This is Madhav. So today I do have an young and the most energetic leader with me. So generally it's a courtesy for me to go ahead and give an introduction. But right now, I don't think I'm capable enough to give an introduction for a great leader who's in front of me. So I'll just directly start with him. Thanking him for giving us this opportunity to be a part of, an interview with him. So first of all, thank you very much for giving this opportunity, sir. You're in Dallas, and I guess this is you've been many times in Dallas, so how are you feeling over here?
I visit America, I meet all Hindu communities here, Hindu friends, and I really feel that I am in India same too. I don't miss India, meeting all these people. So even Dallas, it's a good place where I could see good Hindu activities. People are doing good. And by the way, these Hindu communities are contributing their might to soil of America. So mutual, that relationship is very good, and I really appreciate that.
Sir, I know this would be a normal question to you in every interview. Just wanted to know again, why did you choose this path? And why did you become a religious, spiritual guru?
I don't say I did choose this path. I cannot say that, because this is not a thing that you seek and you get it. No, it is to be given by a guru if he sees that you are deserving person for this. So my guru, he thought, so I'm capable of handling it. So I received it. So it is not that I got it, I received it.
And sir, we know that you have a very strong bonding with your mom, and because of your mom you are into this field. And in one of your interview you told, I remember you telling that this path, since you took, there is a chance that it could stop you from doing something good for the society. So was there a situation wherein you felt that because of this path that you chose, you couldn't do something good for the society?
Spirituality is beyond what a common man's thinking, and spirituality is not away from common man livelihood or anything. So there is a slight difference. So a common thinking cannot reach out to that spiritual path. So for which I could see that spiritual path is helping me to regain energy, to restore my inner strength properly. But at the same time, some commitment towards this, some time has to be dedicated and commitment for doing some things which are to be done in this path, being in this path. That may not allow me to do something which is essential there. So now I need to compromise in many situations where I have to compromise. So for a great cause, for a good cause, compromising these things, I could see it is not a big flaw or fundamental problem. So, and I don't compromise, but I can practice it. So spending my valuable time for that, I can really share my time or anything.
Wanted to know, what is the difference between a saint and a normal human? Or it is correct, let me put it in other words, how can a normal man attain that godliness or the, saintlyhood, yeah.
I don't say saint is a superman or abnormal person. But a saint by nature, a person is considered to be a saint. Even though I wear a cloth, this ochre cloth. So, though internally I am not matured enough to handle this saintlyhood, so I may not consider that I am a saint for that. I am fit enough to be. So, saintliness is a nature, is a quality that one has to imbibe by undergoing that practice. And that background has to be created properly, that maturity levels of a person, that gives a person as a saintlyhood. So therefore, a common man you know, the transformation inside that makes a person to be a saint. He doesn't need to wear a cloth. A person can be a saint even without wearing a cloth.
When would one can feel that he has achieved that saintlyhood? I mean, like, when is that feeling? Or
actually, one has to be connected with a guru properly, and one has to know our shastra and our viewpoint, the culture that explains that viewpoint, that crux. If I can understand and if I can practice that that shastric view, definitely that one can attain that.
And what is the significance of this orange cloth? Cloth that the saints wear. I mean, generally, whenever we see a guru, he'll be dressed in an orange one piece or a two piece. Does it have a significance? Why not some other color?
Yeah, orange stands for a sacrifice. Orange stands for a commitment. So, like sun, the rising sun. If you see the color of a rising sun is an orange. The fire. So, if you see the color of a fire is an orange. Fire that is, that has a significance of a sacrifice thing. So, sun is symbolic thing that is a commitment. So, he runs the entire universe. Therefore, the sun as well as a fire is a prime, you know, elements which we worship. Being a Hindu, we worship fire. We give oblations to the fire. And we worship Surya, Bhagavan as a god, sun as a god. We do Namaskara, Surya Namaskara. So all the significance they put together, the saffron color that a saint that they wear. So it has that significance, and Hindutva represents that saffron color.
I mean, like, so do you feel bad when there are some unprofessional, gurus, unprofessional gurus, because of which who has been exposed, okay, when they do some bad things? So do you feel bad when every guru community is looked down upon?
I don't feel bad. Why I need to feel bad? See, I told you, just mere wearing this saffron cloth, he cannot be a guru or a saint. So the nature inside that has to bring. So similarly, if any person commits a mistake, that is not the problem with the cloth. So I don't need to feel bad. So that is a personal. Again, I am telling you, if a person commits a rape with 5 years girl or 8 years girl, that guy should not be considered as a Hindu or a Muslim or a Christian or by caste wise or a region wise, religion wise. One should not look into that angle. We should consider him as a criminal. That's it. Finish. Similarly, here also, wearing this cloth, so he matured a person, and he commits a blunders in a society. And he ends up with all mafia, goons, gangs, and all these things. Then we have to consider him in that category. I don't need to feel bad. That's, we have to eject and close the chapter of that. That's it.
So, do you feel that since saints, they do good to the society without any profit. So, do you feel that they have to be part of politics and? Almost all political parties should have some saints in them, and they should rule the country or the states so that something good would happen to the society.
See, a ruling part, I may not be very clear about that, but saints, you cannot divide them from the political angle, because all ashrams, mandir, everything is in the threshold of government. So directly or indirectly, they are ragged. Saints are being ragged to politics. So, because they are in the hands of politicians. So, they need to know thoroughly what politics is. They need to know what the constitutional laws of Indian government that has framed. So, all these things, saint is to be, you know, well-versed with all these things. As well as a saint has to be well-versed with politics also. If it is necessary for a saint to play a major role to set at the track of a politics or a politician, he has to play that role, inevitably, definitely. He should not avoid saying it is not my duty, no. See, a saint as such has no duty in society. But staying in a society, whenever or wherever his presence is required, he has to ensure that his presence will bring change. So definitely he has to accept it.
I mean, like, So you're known for your humorous speeches, okay. But in addition to them, you're also very aggressive at times when you give your speeches. I know that you can't face adharma, so you become aggressive at times. So may I know the reason why?
I don't say I'm known for humorous speeches or aggressive, but I'm known that I speak sensibly.
Yeah, that's true. You speak sensibly with that humorous touch, wherein it will be easy for people to understand. But at times, after watching your videos, we felt that you also be aggressive at times.
But it's not an aggressive speech or anything. It is a feeling towards dharma. Like if someone slaps, if somebody says you are a saint, you should not respond. That's not a saintlyhood. If I am hungry, I should ask Bhikshandehi. That's my system. So, no one can say, you are a saint, you should not ask for food. Similarly, if I am hungry, asking, you know, for alms is my, you know, dharma. Then something happens for dharma if I raise my voice, if I ask people to just come together and protect dharma. That is not an aggressive part. That is my basic fundamental right, that I have to speak, I have to raise my voice, that's it.
And today's world, to do something good, you need to bribe someone or, you need to do all the flaws, use some flaws. So you've been doing all these goods. So have you ever in your life bribed someone or used your influence or something to achieve, or I don't say to do to make your job complete your job, but the thing which you actually you are right to do, you right to get from the government. Have you used these bribing options or any other thing?
Till now, by God's grace, I am not being bribed. I didn't bribe anybody. So, but influence part. Sometimes I need to influence them, politician, not to influence to get it done. I need to influence them to understand, realize the need of dharma. So once they realize that need of dharma to be, at least it has to be done properly. So definitely they will do that. So I don't influence for sake of getting things done. I influence them to make them realize the need of it. So that part. Because if I try to influence to get things done, then definitely I should seek that path for everything else. I don't want to get into it. See, whatever thing that I am doing, if I am sure that I am confident that I am doing it with a straight line, that my thought and my word, my deed is in straight line, and it will not hurt or it will not disturb the society, the harmony of the society, and in fact it will support the harmony of society, definitely I will make sure that the person who is responsible to get it done, so I make sure that he will realize the need of it. That's it. I influence a person, not I don't influence the issue. Because it is his duty to fulfill it. That's it.
And we have been listening to your speeches. You give open challenges to everyone. So have you ever got a threatening calls from any of the politicians or any of them?
I didn't get calls, but threat would be there.
Yeah.
Because if I question somebody, definitely someone may react. But I'm not worried about that. Because by threatening somebody or making somebody feel fear, see, if I have some problem, then I need to rethink. So if I'm very clear about what I'm speaking and what I'm doing, then I don't need to worry about that.
Are you planning to enter politics by any chance, or are you planning to put up a political party? I mean, based on the speech that you gave, I mean, and the news channel you were referring to, and how truth that new channel runs and how many people it has exposed. Just wanted to ask this question.
Yeah. See, the channel part, I could say that it is a good platform for all Telugu people till now. I want it to expand to every other regional language there in India. So suppose by God's grace it would be done in near future. But for Telugu people now, we have a voice, we have a platform to just at least reverberate our voice. to make sure that government can listen our voice. So the amount of betrayal is going for our dharma, is happening to our dharma, and the dharma is facing lot of disturbances, turbulence from all these different corners of society, like religious atrocities and many evil disturbances that dharma is undergoing. That our channel Bharat today, I think it is doing good to bring that to the society properly, to the government properly, to the view of a government. And we are also succeeding in many points, like appointing a converted person, converted politician to TTD member. As a TTD member, we raised that issue, we brought into limelight, and party has really realized it. And herself, personally, she herself resigned from that, and she said no for this post. So many things that is being happened because we have a channel, we have a platform. I consider channel is a platform where we need to play a proper play. That's it. We have to play a proper role. So it is not a manipulated role. We have to play a strict dharmic role. That's it. So we are not sold out channel for any party or for any person or for any business purpose or anything. We are strictly observing that, and we are committed for patriotic feelings and dharma, protection of dharma. And when it comes to politics, my personal feeling is, if I have to take care of dharma, if I have to do something for dharma by adopting this path, so if it is inevitable, definitely I adopt that. So whether a politics or any practicing of any other thing, so definitely I adopt that. I don't resist, I don't deny, because nothing can bind me. I don't have any clinch or any hitch over anything else. So
right now you're not thinking to join politics?
No, it's not a thinking, it is a demand. If situation demands, I don't need to think. Because I think always the thoughts are being created by Almighty. It is there, that it is designed. If I am now, it demands, the situation demands that I may need, definitely I will take it up. It is not my choice.
And there's one question which I have, which is, what is Hinduism? I know Hindutva is a very big ocean wherein I don't want. Can you just explain in a brief one sentence, what is Hinduism? And do we have any book which says that Hindu is
Hindu? The word Hindu, everyone has to know, it's not given by anybody. The name Hindu is not given by anybody. We have a dhatu in our Sanskrit grammar, him. So him means hinsa. Hinsa means violence. So dushayati khandayati. One who dispels violence is called Hindu. At the same time, if someone creates violence for us, we should not keep our mouth shut. Equally, we should fix him in right place. We should not disturb anybody's harmony or anybody's happiness or anything. At the same time, if somebody disturbs the harmony of dharma, so we should never allow them to do that. We should fix him in right place. So that's what Hindutva is.
And is it possible for us to remove these words which end with ism or mik or inity, I mean like the Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism or Christianity or Islamic from the dictionaries? From the dictionary, if you remove it, would it be a, then we can see a better future, a better society?
I don't know about anything else, but Hindutva is not a ism, Hindu dharma. So pronouncing it as a Hinduism is a problem, kind of a problem it has. But if you remove Christianity, Islam or Buddhism or any other ism or anything, it won't cause much damage for any society. But if you try to remove Hindutva, Hindu dharma, from the dictionary, then the humanity is going to face a hell. Because Hindutva is the only dharma which has an universal view, universal brotherhood, and universal peace, and the only dharma that prays for everyone's well-being. Therefore, removing Hindutva is removing my well-being attitude.
Yeah, okay, then, so is it fine if we remove the caste-based system or the religion-based reservations, caste-based reservations or religion-based reservation, then we could see a better society and better future?
I don't want to jump into this question, reservations and all. It's a political drama. These political goons, they have played a disastrous role for our, to damage our culture different way. But reservation to an extent, like Dalits, like BCs they have. Definitely, I do accept such communities required, that reservations, to regain their strength back. And they have to stand on their legs. But reservations, if it is manipulated, if it is abused, anybody, it has to be taken care properly. Because that is the dream of Baba Saheb Ambedkar. So therefore, great people who has, visualized something for a better society, we are very small to, talk about that, discuss about that.
I had one question regarding the constitution also. Is it like, since the constitution was written very old, does it needs any change? Do you think that it needs any change? Because when we talk about this reservations, he wrote that yes, Dalits and everyone needed reservation at one point, wherein so that everyone would be at the same pace when they start.
But Ambedkarji said reservation you need not extend for years together.
Right.
See, like a small kid requires an attention of a mother.
Right.
But if a grown-up person requires an attention of a mother, that means there is a defect in a person. Isn't it? So there is no defect for Dalits. Dalits need to be focused properly that they should stand on their legs. That's it. But people who have become a ministers in that, who have earned crores of money, who are multimillionaires, and their sons are being educated properly, and they are well-placed and well-placed in a good society. And these people, they have to surrender their reservations to the country properly so that the other Dalit will be taken care properly. So if they surrender their reservations, the density of reservation will grow properly. That will be distributed properly. Now, a Dalit person who has achieved in the name of reservation everything, and a Dalit who didn't achieve anything in the name of reservation, but still he is there somewhere, he didn't achieve anything. That means an achieved Dalit is a big enemy for non-achieved Dalit. Therefore, this has to be handled properly.
So, change has to be required in the constitution?
Yeah. Many Dalit community, many more people still in Dalit community, really I feel for them, they didn't really achieve anything. Really poor guys. Proper education is not there. Proper medication is not there. There is no money for them to survive. There is no proper, awareness for them in a society to lead their life. We need to take care of them. Irrespective of caste or community or anything, they are our people. Okay. But Ambedkar, what the vision of an Ambedkar need to be carried to that kind of people. I sincerely say, if Desi Plaza is being watched by a Dalit people who reached a good heights in a society, if they have a good heart, kind heart, let them surrender their reservation. And the strength of reservation should be really measured for the people who are innocent in Dalits.
And since we had touched this Dalit topic, I want to ask you one thing. Even today, untouchability is a practice which is somewhere it practiced in some parts of India. Over here we call it a different word called...
See, I could say untouchability is based on hygienity. It is not just because of casteism. Like, if you go to a hospital, if you go to ICU, you are untouchable. You should not touch any patient there. And doctor says you are untouchable, remain outside. You should not enter inside. And if you have to go inside, you have to wear many things and you have to take care of yourself so that you should not carry all unwanted things to the patients and you disturb their life. Similarly, in olden days, untouchability of two types, based on hygienity, one thing, and based on contagious, you know, diseases which are damaging the society and which has less medication for that. So with that view that is being brought, even in a bigger families, rich families, grown-up families, or reputed families, even there, if ladies, they undergo monthly periodical things, they keep them aside. They are also untouchable for 4 days. Why? Because hygienity. So any part in Hindutva, if untouchability is spelt, please don't consider it for a caste or a person. It is for a hygienity purpose. For a purpose it is said, but it is wrongly attributed. It is wrongly used. It is abused in a way.
I mean, how? Yeah. So, how can we actually remove this abuse from some people's mind? I mean, how can we?
We have to educate them. Educate them. Educate them. Constant education, awareness. Bring awareness. No Dalit is untouchable. Yeah.
So yeah, and even okay, when we talked, when we had a talk about women's. So in Hinduism, women's are. I mean, like, it's a myth or it's a myth again, or it's a practical, I don't know, but women are subservient. It's not because of the religion, but it's because of people, the culture and the people who use religion to keep them down. How can we remove it?
In Hindutva, women is considered his highest, you know, principal element.
Right.
So we call mother land, is called Bharat Mata, not Pita. Go Mata, Gita Mata, Ganga Mata. So Tulsi Mata. So we call everything as a Mata. So Matri Bhavana Samajam is Bharat Desham. So India is mother based attitude. The society is mother based attitude. Mother based attitude. Therefore, Veda declares Matri Devo Bhava. First word it declares Matri Devo Bhava. So therefore, according to Hindu Dharma, Yatra Naryastu Pujyante Ramante Tatra Devata. Where a woman is worshipped as a wife, as a mother, as a daughter, where mother, a woman is worshipped. See, all this rapist, all these things are going. 5 years, 8 years, girl. Have you heard in our Purana or anywhere? Rakshasas used to do that. Not rishis, not common people or devatas. Rakshasas used to do that. Now these rakshasas in other form, they are doing that.
So, I mean, like, regarding when I asked the question about constitution being changed, is it like for these people who are criminals, they have to be treated as criminals? Criminals. So when it comes to these, when they are putting these women down, rapes, so they should be hanged till death, that's, or what is that? You?
I don't have any preference, but the pain that kid that undergoes, even you kill a person 10 times, you cannot, you know, alter it that. So, the baby, the kid need to be taken care properly by a government and society. And these people, they are not allowed for a society. I don't say to kill them or to hang them till death or anything, but they are not allowed to be in a society, part of a society. They are not human beings. They are worse than dangerous animals. Yeah.
And there's again one more myth wherein the population of India is less than the gods that Hindus actually pray. We do have 300 million gods we pray. So, and again, within the Hindus, people get divided and they pray to some gods. So within Hinduism, we are not united. I mean, like, this is actually a question from one of my colleague, not mine. So I would really say, do not, I mean, like, I'm sorry. Yeah, so it's like, within Hinduism, there are many people who are not united. So why can't the preachers, spiritual gurus, first preach that instead of praying to different sects of God, pray to one almighty, get united, and then they could focus on Hinduism, preaching Hinduism and other...
According to Hindu Dharma, there is no one God. There is no many gods. There is only God.
Right.
There is no one God. One God business we don't accept. Or many God business we don't accept. Hindu Dharma says there is only God. So I see God in tree. For me, tree is a God. For me, Surya is God. Lord of Sun is God. For me, moon is God. For me, stars are God. Rivers are God. Ganga is God for me. Water is God for me. Earth is God for me. So therefore, in that aspect, God is not sitting somewhere up above and as a contractor, he is watching everything. Like a CIA or CBI in India. He is watching everything, monitoring. No, nothing, nonsense. So God is manifesting in the form of this creation. God is giving you fruits in the form of mango tree. God is flowing in the form of a river to quench your thirst. Okay? God has taken the shape of a earth which gives you food. He gives you to walk and run, jump and play, live happily on this earth. So, according to Hindu Dharma, Isha Vasyam Idam Sarvam. One should know the intrinsic feeling of Hindu Dharma, not the outside things of it. See, when I look into you, you look so fair. That doesn't mean you are fair inside. Or you might be fair inside too. So, mere my color of skin will not say that my quality of my thoughts or anything. So, if I am black, I don't say that my thoughts are black. If I am fair, I'm red, so my thoughts are red, my thoughts are white, I cannot say. So similarly, Hindu Dharma don't read between the lines. So anybody, not me, not you, I'm telling. People who are there purposefully, they just read between the lines and they talk some nonsense and they try to throw some mud on Hindutva or anything. These people are useless. In my view, these people are brainless and shameless. They don't have shame. Because they read between lines. And you know this Prakash Raj, brainless fellow. He's a gunda as an actor. As an actor, he does good acting, action portion as a gunda. But unfortunate thing, he's behaving like a gunda even in outside. Yeah, he plays a role of a rowdy beautifully in movies. But unfortunate thing that is being extended even outside also, in society, real life. So that's where these people, they just read between lines and they talk about Hindutva. They know nothing about Hindutva. I ask him how the word Hindutva has come. He says, somebody has given you the name Hindutva. That fellow shamelessly, he speaks that. He doesn't know the basics and fundamentals of Hindutva. So similarly, we don't worship many gods. Nor we worship one God. We worship only God. For us, water is God. We worship water. So therefore, we love nature, we worship nature, a great thing that no religion has. So appreciate that. This is more scientific, not more scientific. Science should learn something from this, if at all. Yeah.
And it's like there's one more thing which is an extended question to this one. When spiritual gurus, they preach, so why don't they preach humanity? I mean, like, I know Hinduism is wherein you told it, Hindu Dharma, wherein humanity comes first. But instead of using those in the name of religion, rather than preaching humanity, why can't remove religion and just preach humanity? Everyone. This is actually to all the spiritual gurus.
No, I'm telling you, in Hindu Dharma, the religion part is very less. The spiritual path is more. So unless or until you undergo these religious practices, you cannot reach out to that spiritual path. Okay? Reaching out to spiritual path is the ultimate point of Hindu Dharma. Not making a person to remain as a religious person is not Hindu Dharma's view. The dharmic view of a Hindutva is to make a person journey from religion to spirituality. So, if at all, if I am not capable of practicing religious things and I'll be incapable of pursuing the spiritual path. Therefore, the religious pursuit is inevitably required. So, what religious pursuit is? If you have a question, no Hindutva says you accept God. If you don't believe God, you will be beheaded. So that no Hindutva says, even if I don't believe God, if I disbelieve, Hindutva says, you are equally, you have a right, equal right, like how one person believes God. So your right to live is not being obstructed by belief or non-belief. Whereas other religion, they don't accept. They are religion. So ours is dharma. Therefore, even you cannot say the meaning for dharma is religion. No, no.
And this is totally different. I have some questions with me which I've gathered from different colleagues of mine. So one basic question that everyone was asking was, India is a developing country and we do have poor people outside temples. So when we worship gods, why do we worship with edible things and why can't we replace those edible things with non-edible things like kumkum or turmeric and give those edible things to the people who are sitting outside?
See, see, this question itself has a, you know, problem. We worship God with edible things, like milk, like curd, okay? We question that. But I'm telling you, no poor sitting outside temple is a poor. He gets every day 400 rupees minimum.
That's right.
Minimum 400
but
rupees.
Still, other than those.
No, I challenged this actor Kamal Haasan also. He said, poor beggars are there outside temple and God is rich. So I don't want this God, rich God. So I said, being a Kamal Haasan, how many beggars have you saved in your lifetime? So our God doesn't declare, but outside people who are sitting, the temple, people who ask for things, they get every day 400 rupees. And temple feed them, annadanam, they give. So therefore, do you think you pour 1 liter of milk is being wasted? You feel that every day 1 lakh people is fed in the name of temple, annadanam. Why don't you consider that? So you cannot question the Shastric view. So it has to be done. We give oblations into fire. Like a ghee. Ghee per a kilo, it is very valuable thing. You cannot say 1,000 rupees per a kilo. Why we want to pour it in a fire? No, it is being taken care. It is purifying the entire system. So there is every behind every act, there is a fact. You need to know the fact behind the act. You don't want to know the fact behind the act. And just you want to jump into that. And you want to question and you just burn a cloth and throw on the face of a person and you ask him to wipe it off. This is the immoral behavior, shameless behavior of these people. Yeah, these questions, they do come. Tirupati. So for Balaji, we spent 1,000 rupees for an Abhisheka. Whereas every day, 1 lakh people is being fed there in the name of charity Bhagavan. So Bhagavan is feeding 1 lakh people. Why don't you see that?
Why can't you go according to the Shastras and
Yeah, definitely one has to follow Shastric view and these people have no right to question that. You don't believe God, why you are questioning all these things? And you have no right to question, it is my wish. I do it. I am not pulling your money. I am spending my money. And what right you have got, what business you have got there. If you believe our system, come. Take to this kind of an initiation and you get initiated into it. You learn and you follow, you practice. Then you will know what things are. You cannot sit somewhere and question these things to get answers.
And one similar question like this, I mean like women. They are not allowed to, why can't they do some activities which men do? For example, burial ground, why can't they do the cremation stuff? Why are they not allowed to enter some temples, Shani temple or other? So does it has some reason behind it?
See, this is what I'm telling you. Why do they insist? They are not allowed, they don't allow. There is no such thing called not allowed. Even Shani temples, all ladies are allowed. But people who are undergoing some periodical changes or anything, they said you are restricted because once you finish that, you are allowed there. So, okay, even Shabarimala, all women folks are allowed. But there is no such thing that women are not allowed. It's a wrong statement. But people who have that periodical system, they say carrying all these things, and for them it's not good for them. For their health point of view, it is said. Many things it is said in Shastra. So these things, if you want to pull out, I will question. Muslim friends in Muharram, they take blade and they hit on their body and they shed blood. Why don't you guys question them? What fact behind this act? What is the rational thinking behind this act? Why don't you question them? Why don't you question Christian friends that Jesus is dead? After 3 days, you say he will wake up. 3 days, third day he will wake up. How many years have gone now? 2,000 years have gone. Till now, I don't think he is awake now. So he has come from that burial ground. How it is possible a person who is dead can come after 3 days?
So before I conclude this, is there any message that you want to give it to the viewers to the young generation that we have?
I sincerely say, people who want to know sincerely what Hindutva, Hindu Dharma is, there is a process. So you need to undergo that. You need to just sit and listen from Guru properly. It is a tradition. It is a methodology. You need to undergo that. You cannot just question a scientist in a road. Okay, in a busy road, you cannot question a scientist. Why hydrogen, two molecules and oxygen together will give water? So I will give you hydrogen, I will give you oxygen, you create water right now. If you ask a scientist, what an answer will be from scientist. Similarly, you cannot ask a question, silly questions like this, or any Shastri question, serious questions, just for a person on a road or in a debate or anything. You need to know things by way of, learning and listening to him and practicing things, you will realize it. So I sincerely say, every act in Hindu Dharma is presupposed by its fact. So every act has a fact behind. So we don't need to worry. We have every reason to establish that. So Hindutva is the only dharma, everlasting dharma. So it is going to be evergreen dharma.
Is it like you want to say something about the 3 G's? I forgot to ask about it. The 3 G's which you have started back in India, the Gurukulam and all. So thank you, sir. Thank you for giving us this opportunity. Hope again we'll meet very soon once you have achieved in your proceedings.
Thank you for the viewers as well as viewers across this globe who can watch this by social media or anything. So I wish all of them, and I wish the humanity should grow well, not with ill, so well. So I pray for their well-being. Thank you.
So thank you, Desi Plaza viewers. Next time I'll be again with you guys with one more great celebrity with me. Till then, cheers, bye. Signing off, Madhav.